joining me here to discuss the election details. Well, kind of give you a behind the scenes look of just how everything kind of went down here at Rogers TV as we were covering the election in a very in-depth fashion. I have Rhonda Taylor, Jackie Vieira, as well as Ginella Massa, all three great reporters here on the Rogers TV roster. Thank you again, ladies, for joining me. These are the kind of conversations I love to have because it's like a behind the scenes, inside the reporter studio style of chat. And Ginella, you had the unfortunate pleasure to interview John Sanderson after, unfortunately, the news came out that Linda Jeffrey was elected, and just kind of explain just, you know, how it was being at the Sanderson camp. Here's someone that really did work hard. You know, he mentioned, you know, he did do a lot of door knocking. I'll even say that this past weekend, being a Brampton citizen, I saw him a lot in a lot of the ethnic media. He was, you know, definitely making his rounds. Just explain, you know, how it was being at the Sanderson camp.
Oh, I will say it is nice to be at the desk and chatting with you because we're all in the field, so we don't get to have these election.
I had the easy job last night, but.
But yes, you know, Sanderson was the last interview that we did of the evening. We were kind of running around all over the place in Brampton last night. And when we got to the hall, it was quite a big hall, and it was pretty empty. And, you know, the mood's a little sad. It's a little disappointing when you go to the runner-up. And he was visibly disappointed. You could see in that interview. He felt like he really had a chance. He was disappointed that he wasn't able to take it over the top. And he said, as he mentioned, he was the one who had brought forward that forensic audit. He was the one who kind of brought all of that into light when it came to the scandal with Susan Fennell. So I think he felt like he was the one who got that ball rolling. He was the one who wanted to bring, you know, transparency and accountability to Brampton. And he was, you know, disappointed that it didn't vote in his favor.
Yeah, like, you know, kudos to his campaign. You know, he was able to, you know, get second place, and you know, that's even surpassing the incumbent Susan Fennell, who we'll definitely touch on later on in the show. But, you know, again, like, his sentiment of saying that, you know, he went door to door, he did some door knocking. He was able to connect with individuals on a personal basis. He was able to be the one to bring forth this forensic audit that had definitely kind of shook Brampton within its core. Some consistent feedback that I've been seeing across the board from a lot of candidates, whether it be, you know, from a mayoral standpoint, from a candidate, from a counselor standpoint. Any thoughts on just that notion that, you know, what you're hearing on the field isn't necessarily what's translating into votes?
I think that we talked a little bit in the break about incumbents and how that kind of factors in, and a lot of time that name recognition automatically puts them in the front runner position. But in both these situations, we have an incumbent who'd been in for so many, you know, 13 terms, and an incumbent who had been plagued by a scandal. Mm-hmm. So it kind of opened the door really wide for
Definitely.
Other people to come in. And I think that those polls, some people felt like it really could be anybody's race. It really was an opportunity for anyone to kind of capture that.
And, you know, we were chatting briefly about, you know, Linda Jeffrey and her victory in Brampton, and we chatted, you know, about Bronnie Crombie's victory in Mississauga. But let's go down to the councilor level now. Let's start in Brampton. A lot of changes in Brampton, and Ginella, you were at the front of all a lot of that. You know, you interviewed Gurpreet Dhillon as well as Vicky Dhillon, who were both running against each other, with Gurpreet Dhillon winning the seat in Wards 7 and 8. Just kind of talk about that and just, you know, your experience kind of talking with both opponents, I would say.
Yeah, so we went to, we went to Gurpreet Dhillon's campaign party first, and I actually wasn't originally assigned to that riding. Mm-hmm. And I got a call from our producer who said, you've got to go to Gurpreet Dhillon's campaign party because he's winning by a lot, and he's going to unseat the incumbent there.
Oh, wow.
And so it was a big upset. So we get there, and it's just a party. Like, drums, chanting, cheering. They're holding him up on his shoulders. It was like a sequel.
Wow.
Like,
But, you know, but I can even say, being in the studio at one point, I was reading the results, and it came to Ward 7 and 8, and at one point, Vicky and Gurpreet were tied.
Mm.
And it was really interesting to see, because I'm like, you know, this is anybody's ballgame at this point. You know, mm-hmm. both were sitting at 3,910 seats, 10 votes at the time, I would say that was probably the race to watch at that point, because it could have gone either way, with a lot of the races being very dominant in who was being chosen to win.
Yeah, Gurpreet won by 40% of the vote, which
Excellent.
Is huge.
Definitely.
Vicky Dhillon held onto that seat, had that seat for two terms,
yes.
and he had won last time by, I think, 35 or 36%. So he had won by a large majority before. So I know that Gurpreet was really excited. This is his first time, you know, as a city councilor, running for city council. Mm-hmm. And he talked a little bit about just, you know, residents wanting change, residents wanting transparency, and, you know, being really excited to be on city council.
Lots of words for Gurpreet too, you know, good for him. You know, and one thing I wanted to chat about briefly is Gurpreet's one of the younger candidates that was running. And do you think, you know, with him being in office, this is potentially a shift, you know, for the future of a more youthful city council?
Yeah, I just on his reaction that yes, I think he even was genuinely surprised.
He seemed like it, yeah.
He was at a loss for words there. But yeah, even looking at the faces of the people who were there, who were supporting him, who were his volunteers, there were a lot of young people out there supporting him and celebrating for him. So yeah, I think this is an opportunity for young people to look up to someone like him, who's able to take office, who's able to make a change, and really care about municipal politics. And I think it's an opportunity to see that kind of shift.
Yeah, this is an individual who you know, ran provincially and was very close, yes, of obtaining a seat in Brampton as well for the NDP party. So, you know, our congrats to Gurpreet Dhillon, who was able to win a seat in the city council race.
You're in a public light. You have to present yourself publicly.
I think absolutely, yeah. And I think you're absolutely right in that you don't really know what's going to be next. You know,
exactly.
I talked to John Sanderson. We saw that interview, and I asked him what's next, and he was kind of vague, but he alluded to the fact that we haven't seen the last of him. Mm-hmm. And I think it is important for them to show that, you know, even if they've lost, you know, they still have the city of Brampton. They have the city's best interest at heart, and that's all they really wanted to do. That's the only reason that they wanted to win. I think it's important to kind of put that angle on it, as opposed to making it like a personal loss.
Well, especially in the you know, when you face defeat, I think overall it's all about kind of, you know, there's that notion of saving face.
Yes.
And I think in any situation, whether it be provincial, federally, or municipally, when it comes to making that address, you know, that address focused around not winning and not being the one elected, I think there's a lot more pressure upon these individuals to really, you know, hold their head up high and really show what they're about.
It's much harder.
Definitely. We will be back actually after this brief commercial message here on Cable 10 Live. Ginella and Rob, I'm curious to get your thoughts on the on some of the results in Mississauga, and in particular, Caroline Parrish, who won Ward 5, Bonnie Crombie's former ward. And we all know Caroline Parrish and Bonnie Crombie don't necessarily see eye to eye. How do you see this playing out as we move forward with the new city council in Mississauga?
This is going to be interesting because it's almost like we are already going into council with a divide.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's always tough when you have, you know, it's not like the provincial elections where you've kind of got the party politics and you know where everybody stands,
yes,
you know how many mm-hmm. seats you have. You've got to kind of do your campaigning within the mm-hmm. office now to see who's going to be on your side, who's going to vote with you, and so that's going to be interesting to watch.
And I think the other thing that's going to push it forward is that Hazel is strongly supporting Crombie and is going to be supporting Crombie after this election as well. She said, I will be your advisor. So I think knowing that those agendas mm-hmm. are still very, very arguably similar,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
especially when it comes to transportation, some other mm-hmm. aspects as well. Caroline Parrish, I will suspect there will be a lot of tension in council. And I think that it's going to be a lot of old issues that are just going to keep stemming up as well.
I made the comparison last night that, you know, a city council is kind of like a board of directors. Mm-hmm. You know, you have a lot of individuals who are in power and very much so to make some very important decisions. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, those kind of dynamics bring out the best in individuals. Do you see this kind of working in a positive sense in Mississauga, where, you know, you have individuals, you know, such as even Matt Mahoney, who was elected, you know, in his mother's former ward, in Mississauga Ward 8. Steve Mahoney's son. Do you see these kind of elements, you know, finding ways in which we create a very dynamic culture in Mississauga?
I think to an extent, because we have to remember as well, everyone has their own set agendas of what they're trying to achieve.
Exactly.
So I think now it's also, because there are fresh faces in council, it's what is going to be the new direction of Mississauga?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because Mississauga went down a very good path for 36 years because it was under the leadership of Hazel.
Mm-hmm.
But if Mahoney has a way that he's envisioning at least his ward, Parrish is envisioning, you know, the ward, because they chose to run for council, they did not choose to run for mayorship,
mm-hmm.
then what's going to be the new direction? Is Bonnie Crombie going to be able to accommodate the needs that they have, at least for the ward, and if not for the big city picture?
Ginella, your thoughts?
I was just going to say, it's interesting that you say that, because I'm not sure that all city councilors always see it that way. You know, sometimes it's a means to an end. We have to
recognize
that, you know, people have their own political ambitions as well. So sometimes certain councilors may genuinely have the concerns of their ward at heart, and they're there to represent their representatives, to represent their constituents. But there are other councils who want to look at the picture, who want to look at the city as a whole, who want to make a mark and make their name in politics as to say, you know, I was the one who put this forward, I was the one who started this initiative, right? So those are kind of two different modes of operating in city council.
Rob,
right?
Chime in.
Well, it's also
Rob is like very eagerly wanting to come on.
Yeah, you know what, at the end of the day, if you're a counselor, I want to know that my counselor will be representing my views towards council. The other thing about it is that you're always going to have the politics that some companies or corporations might be supporting one counselor, not the other. And I don't want to say that this is going to happen, but what happens if you get into a blackmail type situation where it goes, well, they're supporting me now, so if I'm going to help you, you can't be helping that person. Is any of that going to happen? Is that going to intertwine? Because I heard rumors that was happening in Brampton.
Well, I was just going to bring that up in Brampton, because businesses, small businesses was a big issue in Brampton, especially in some of the wards that I was representing, right? The ability for small businesses to flourish.
Exactly.
So when you're able to kind of do things for certain businesses, what does that mean when you're helping them out?
Mm-hmm. I really want to touch on one interesting fact about Mississauga, is you had 3 seats that were vacated. Mm-hmm. And you had 8 other seats where the incumbents were running to defend their current positions. Mm-hmm. All 8 of those incumbents won by massive landslides. You know, Jim Toby got reelected. Ron Starr got reelected. What kind of dynamic would you kind of explain that? You know, there's not too much change to the council. And you know, just the fact that a lot of these individuals won by such high margins, does it go to show that hard work pays off? And Jackie, please share your thoughts on this.
Well, I've heard some things about one counselor in particular, and I don't know if I should say his name or not, but basically that this person never actually attended some of the debates in his ward, and this is coming from one of his opponents. So I don't know, and this person was voted in, they won. So.
Well, we talked about name recognition, right?
Exactly. So it's like they think is it an easy vote? I don't know. And the fact is that now Bonnie's mayor, and so we have 8 who have been
re-elected.
So they can, I guess, hopefully work together, or they know each other. They know each other well enough. Whereas it's up to the other 4, I would say. 4 or 3.
If I was a political analyst, I'd really study Mississauga's government because I think longevity is the key. You know, we saw it with Mayor McCallan. We're seeing it now with a lot of these councillors who have spent quite some time on the council. What do you think the secret is?
Well, I'm not sure if I'm going to answer your question, because I had a point that I wanted to make.
Oh,
maybe
feel free.
This will kind of touch on it. But I just wanted to say that, you know, a leadership change. Maybe this is in line with what you're asking. A leadership change doesn't necessarily mean a change in City Hall.
Okay.
Because of the fact, like, let's look at the numbers, right? Mm-hmm. 8 out of 11 city councilors have been reelected. The majority of that city council remains intact. Mm-hmm. So the same ideas, the same, you know, ideologies are going to continue to be put forward, even though the face is different, even though the person who's leading the group is different. At the
end of
the day,
she
only has, you know, one vote,
former city councilor herself is just working with the same individuals.
Exactly.
So.
I think the other thing about it is that, and it also brings up the question, are people happy with the councilors they had before because they have all been reelected, right?
Apparently. It would suggest so,
yeah.
But I mean, that could also be one of the reasons. I mean, Mississauga has progressed well. People liked Hazel. There was a great reputation. There was growth. There was attention to... you know, whether it's to events or to what was happening in the neighborhoods, there was development. So if you like what's happening around you,
why change it?
It's
not broke, don't fix it,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Well, even like that was a lot of the feedback that was kind of given when it came to the selection of Mississauga was, you know, a lot of citizens are happy, you know, with the way Mississauga has been. You know, sure, there's things that people always want that, you know, will make life better, but generally, Mississauga has been a very prosperous city, and when you even, you know, let's go back to the mayoral races. When you look at Bonnie Crombie's platform versus Steve Mahoney's platform,
so similar,
very much similar, and you know, they both seem to have outlined just the main issues that are currently affecting the city, and I guess a lot can be trickled down to the councillors as well.
Yeah, I mean, and when we look at Mississauga and compare it to Brampton, right, it's a different, completely different story. People seem happy with what's going on in Mississauga. They feel like, these guys have been doing a great job. No need to change it around. Let's just keep going the way we're going. Whereas Brampton, it was very different, where they said there is a big issue in City Hall.
Yes.
Whether or not it came from the councillors or came from the mayor, they wanted to see a change. We saw a lot of turnover in the incumbents being kicked out of their seats, so it's very different.
Ladies, actually, when we get back from commercial break, rather, I know you want to chime in, but I want to give you time. But I want to talk about voter turnout. Very interesting. Toronto saw a high amount, but in Peel we did not. We'll be back after this brief commercial message. I do want to come back to this topic, but quickly, I think what's really important was voter turnout. Toronto, as you know, saw some really good turnout. 60% of their voter population came out and voted for a new mayor as for John Tory. But in Mississauga and Brampton, both turnouts, you know, though it was higher than previous years, still very small compared to Toronto at 36%. And for me, you know, covering this election on Cable 10 Live, you know, seeing a lot of the main news outlets putting a lot of emphasis on the Brampton and Mississauga race, there was a lot of talk, especially in my community, about this election. The fact that I'm seeing it at 36%, I'm very surprised.
I'm actually really surprised, too. You know, full disclosure, I'm from Toronto. I live in Toronto. So watching that race is really important to me. But at the same time, you know.
So you're part of the 60%.
I'm part of that 61% that voted. And like, that's a different story because, you know, that Toronto was making international headlines with with this mayoral race. So that's different. But I think that I'm surprised to see that voter turnout so low because this was a historic election for Mississauga. To be, you know, as I mentioned, this maybe is the first time people would have an opportunity to vote for someone new, some fresh blood, and really have an opportunity to maybe change the direction of the city or at least have a say as to what they want to see different in the city. And then as for Brampton, we talked about the spending scandal and, you know, wanting to change that kind of attitude in Brampton City Hall. I'm surprised that voter turnout wasn't higher.
I am not surprised, to be quite honest, simply because, I have to say it, the media in Toronto didn't really put out much information about Mississauga and Brampton. They were just talking about the mayoral candidates, but they didn't talk about much else. Mm-hmm. And it just seemed like it was all about Toronto. I don't know if you noticed, if you're watching the news, you know, in the weeks in or
like we're definitely up. We're catching the feed just to make sure, you know, and it was a lot.
There
of it was
so many debates, so many debates involving, you know, Tory, Chow, and Ford. But there was nothing about Mississauga. Like, it was just, you know, maybe a 2 or 3 minute piece.
Well, that's why we're here.
Exactly.
For people to see what's going
on. Yeah, and you know, kudos to Rogers TV for standing on the forefront here. And what do you think needs to happen to it? Because think about it this way. There were 64% of individuals in both Brampton and Mississauga that didn't vote, which, you know, if they did, the results could have gone either way or they could have been the same. Mm-hmm. What are some ways in which we can kind of get more, or what do you think, more voter turnout in the future?
Well, I think you're right in that access to information is a big part of it, right? If you're not able to know what's going on with the people who are running in your city, if you're not able to access some of the information, and you have to really go out of your way. And you can find it. If you want to find it, you can find it. But when it's not as in your face as some of the other things are, it makes it a little bit more difficult to keep it as top of mind and to make it a priority, to make it to really feel that it's important to get informed.
So actually, thank you, all three of you. Actually, the whole Rogers team for all your hard work last night. Exceptional job. And thank you for tuning in last night, even today. You know, we love hearing from our viewers. We love, you know, presenting you the key facts. And we'll be back here again tomorrow on Rogers TV at 8 p.m. here on Cable 10 Live.